What if the person sitting next to you in the room became short of breath and said that they had chest pain that was radiating across their chest and down their arm, and they got sweaty and they got nauseous? What would you think? Heart attack. Nobody hesitated. Everybody knows. Why do you know? Because the American Heart Association has made this information available nationwide, multi-nationwide, and now virtually everyone is aware of the warning signs of a heart attack. And that's great. How did you know these were symptoms of a heart attack? You've heard it. You've heard it on TV, you've heard it from friends, you've heard it at seminars, you've heard it on public service announcements. You might even know that you would need to lie a person down and see if they're breathing and check their pulse and maybe even give them an aspirin. And if you have ever taken a course in CPR, cardiopulmonary resuscitation, you might even be brave enough to start cardiopulmonary resuscitation, although it's a daunting and intimidating thing to do. You might do that. You may have done that. I don't know. So, let's do another what if. So what if the person sitting to your right or left developed droopiness to their mouth and eye, and they tried to stand up and their leg was weak and they couldn't stand up very well, or they would fall, or they needed your assistance, and then they had trouble speaking, they were slurring their words, or they were saying words that didn't make sense? What if that happened? What would you think? Stroke. Somebody said heart attack, somebody said stroke. Was anybody, raise your hand, don't be embarrassed. Say if you don't know. If you don't know what that might have represented, raise your hand. Okay, so we have one person who raised their hand. Honest man in the back. Okay. So what this person seems to be developing is a relatively sudden onset of the inability to use the muscles on the right side of his body. His face, his leg. It said nothing about his arm, but there are multiple areas on one side of the body that are involved. That's usually a sign that there is a problem going on in the brain. Is that problem a stroke? Is that problem something else? We don't know, but I think the take-home message for today is we're going to assume it's a stroke until proven otherwise. So what would you do? If you don't know, you're not alone. A lot of people don't know what to do in this situation. It's human nature to want to wait it out, make it go away. I've had pain in my left shoulder for the past 2 months. It's killing me. Can't sleep at night. I'm a doctor. You think I'd do something about it, right? What have I been doing? I've been taking ibuprofen and waiting for it to go away. It hasn't gone away. Good thing it wasn't a sign of a heart attack. I'd be dead. But it's human nature to want to wait and wait for it to pass. And I'm not trying to be harsh by saying that. I'm being honest. I think most reasonable people would say, let me just wait a minute and wait for it to go away so I can just get on with my day. But again, those could be signs of a stroke. So as in the setting of someone having a heart attack, it would be good if we knew what to do in a situation like that. Many people who live around us, not just only around us, but other parts of the country, don't really know the signs of a stroke, and they don't realize that help is available. But the message we're trying to give to the community is that a stroke is just as much of an emergency, or even more so, or as much. It depends on how much of an argument I want to get into with the cardiologists. Because the cardiologists think that the heart is the center of the universe, and neurologists think that the brain is the center of the universe, and that the only function of the heart is to keep the brain going. You know, the heart is just kind of there to assist the brain. I think that's the appropriate hierarchy, because without our brains, who are we? Yeah, well, they weigh in with their scope a lot. but anyway, so what we need to think of is, could this be a stroke? Maybe. Maybe we shouldn't wait. Let's call 911. because it is an emergency. And now it's a potentially treatable emergency. When I was doing my training in neurology, I finished my neurology training 20 years ago. So in the early 1990s, when people came into the emergency room with a stroke, we would stand around helplessly and shake our heads and say, should we give them more aspirin? Should we give them a blood thinner called heparin? And we tried all these things. They didn't help. We did stuff because we wanted to feel like we were doing all we could, and we felt like we wanted to do something to intervene and to be helpful. But we weren't helping. The studies showed over and over again that those interventions weren't helpful. I'll get back to that. What's a stroke? Can anybody tell me what a stroke is? If anybody wants to share that information with the group, what you think a stroke is?
Blood clot to the brain.
Yeah, blood clot to the brain. So arteries travel from the chest up the neck into the brain. There are four major conduits, four major arteries that travel. There's two carotid arteries in the front and side of the neck that travel up to the brain, one to the right brain, one to the left brain. There's two vertebral arteries in the back of the neck, and then they travel up and they coalesce at the base of the brain to form the basilar artery, which is at the base of the brain. But anyway, there's four major conduits to get from the heart up to the brain, because the brain's important, like I said, more important than the heart. The heart's function is to keep the brain going. And I say that to the cardiologists when they're here, just not just saying that because they're not here, okay? So anyway, the arteries leading up to the brain can become clogged with platelets. Platelets are the things that cause our blood to clot. We need platelets. We have Dr. Julie Smith here, who's a hematologist. She can tell you the importance of platelets, extremely important. Sometimes, though, you can have disruptions in the wall of an artery, and where there's a disruption and where smooth flow of blood is disrupted, platelets like to hang out and aggregate and call their friends over and clot. In a narrow area like an artery leading up to the brain, that's not always a good thing. If that clot gets too big, or if it doesn't shed away quickly enough, or if it breaks off and travels north, then you can get a disruption of blood flow to an area of the brain supplied by an artery, a branch artery in the brain. And you get lack of blood flow, and you get lack of oxygen. And that lack of blood and oxygen flow results in those brain cells losing their functional ability, and some of those brain cells actually literally die. Depending on the location where that's happening in the brain, different symptoms will occur. Okay, so for example, if one of the large branches of the carotid artery gets occluded and the part of the brain that controls your speaking function is disrupted, and there's lack of blood flow and oxygen, you could lose the ability to speak. If the part of the brain that controls muscle and motor function in the right brain, which controls the left body, is affected, then the left side of the body could be paralyzed. If a blood clot goes to another part of the brain, in the back of the brain that controls vision, your visual perception off to one side of your visual world could be disrupted, and you could lose the ability to perceive vision on one side of your visual world. So strokes can cause a lot of disruption, a lot of dysfunction, depending on what part of the brain they are located in. And they are caused by blood clots that then disrupt the flow of blood and oxygen to specific areas of the brain. So anyway, when a part of the brain is disrupted by a blood clot that does not allow blood to flow and oxygen to supply the brain and keep it healthy, a stroke can occur. That's called an ischemic stroke. Ischemia is a lack of blood flow and oxygen to any part of the body. When the heart gets ischemic, you get a heart attack. When the brain gets ischemic, you get a stroke or a brain attack. Ischemic strokes, lack of blood and oxygen to a specific part of the brain, make up 80% of strokes. They're caused from severe blockage of blood to all parts of the brain or to a localized part of the brain. Generally, it's a localized part of the brain. It usually isn't the entire brain. Another 20% of strokes are called hemorrhagic strokes, where the manifestation in the brain is bleeding into the brain. That's a different phenomenon. It has a different type of treatment. But you should know that there's this 80-20 rule, so that if someone is having a stroke, there's an 80% chance that it's an ischemic stroke from a clot and that there is emergent treatment available. The other 20% that are caused by bleeding into the brain can potentially be treatable depending on what the source of the bleeding is, but the purpose of this lecture is not really to go into that in too much detail. But we will have hopefully time for questions at the end if I don't talk too much, and we can ask questions about that. Okay. Why don't people respond to symptoms? You know, well, maybe they don't recognize the symptoms. Like I said, they just think the symptoms are going to go away. Denial, you know, well, this can't be happening to me. This doesn't happen to me. This happens to other people. Or they think, well, yeah, okay, maybe this is a stroke, but really, what can we do about it? There's nothing that can be done about it. Some people might worry about the cost of care. Some people might just have a fear of the unknown or a fear of interfacing with the medical system and fail to act. And so it can be a perplexing situation for many people. But why is it important to know about this? Because stroke is the fourth leading cause of death in our country. It's the third leading cause in our state. It is a leading cause of disability. Close to 800,000 strokes will occur this year, about one every 40 seconds nationally. Women are twice as likely to die from a stroke than from breast cancer on an annual basis. It costs a lot. You know, the cost of health care, the cost of lost wages, the cost to a family if their primary breadwinner is disabled. Not to mention the emotional cost, which can be equally devastating. Every 4 minutes, someone dies of a stroke. 40% of stroke deaths occur in males and 60% occur in females. And this is not a disease primarily of the elderly. Stroke happens across all age groups. Terry McIntyre, who you met at the beginning, and I, we see patients way too young, some in their late 20s, early 30s, who have developed strokes for a myriad of different reasons. It cuts across multiple age and socioeconomic and ethnic groups. Who's at risk? Well, I feel badly that we're always picking on people with diabetes. I don't think we're picking on them. I think diabetes is just a difficult disease and it affects multiple organ systems. It affects the cardiovascular system in a very significant and serious way. And it makes blood vessels more prone to developing clots and strokes as a result. Cigarette smoking is well known to cause a buildup of plaque and atherosclerosis, not only in the heart, but in the blood vessels in the neck and in the brain. Untreated high blood pressure is a major cause and contributor to stroke. Can somebody please shout out to me what a normal blood pressure is? Normal blood pressure. Thank you. No, thank you. Don't vary. And when you see your doctor and your blood pressure is climbing over 120 over 80 and they say, well, you have pre-hypertension, ask them if you're pregnant or not. Because my question to my doctor would be, well, what are we waiting for? Are we waiting for my first TIA? Are we waiting for my first episode of angina? Are we waiting for my first stroke? When are we going to treat this? 120 over 80. Thank you.
What about the new guidelines for elderly people?
Well, I'm not aware of that.
Yeah, it's come out in the last 3 months.
I'm not aware of that. All right, I'll have to look that up. Yes, sir.
Is weight a factor on that list?
Sedentary lifestyle is, and generally, weight and sedentary lifestyle goes together. High cholesterol, certainly. Atrial fibrillation is a disorder of heart rhythm that causes the heart to beat irregularly. When there is irregular flow of blood across any channel, blood tends to pool. When blood tends to pool, it tends to clot. Blood likes to move. It's like a shark, likes to keep moving. When it stops moving, it gets unhappy. And when it pools, clots can develop. When people have irregular blood flow through the heart through a rhythm abnormality like atrial fibrillation, clots can form and they can travel to any part of the body. When they travel to the brain, they cause an ischemic stroke or a brain attack. Heart defects, some people are born with heart defects, holes in the heart that can cause turbulence of flow to cross from one side of the heart to the other and then travel to the brain. Those with a family history of stroke are at a higher risk. There are some gender differences that we talked about, that women are more likely to have more debilitating strokes or a higher risk of death from stroke than men. Future expectations demographically. Currently, non-nursing home stroke care is about 11% of the Medicare budget. And the direct costs are very high. I don't think any of us can fathom what $180 billion is. But those costs are all projected to rise. If we're not able to change lifestyle and mitigate risk factors, limit risk factors. What are the personal impacts of stroke? What are some disabilities seen in patients greater than age 65, 6 months after stroke? About 20% have some impairment of communication. It could either be because the stroke involved the part of the brain that generates language, and so people are no longer able to generate spoken language, or because their mouth and tongue are so weak that even though they have the ability to generate language, the words that come out sound slurred or are not intelligible enough to be well enough understood. Paralysis on one side of the body occurs in 50% of people with stroke. Walking difficulty occurs in 30%, or I wouldn't say walking difficulty, but inability to walk without assistance. And that could be due to strokes causing paralysis on one side of the body, or strokes affecting the part of the balance center of the brain called the cerebellum. I don't expect you to remember all that. It's just that a person can develop walking difficulty from stroke, not just from a stroke that affects one side of the body, but from strokes that affect other parts of the brain that affect different parts of the body. Post-stroke depression is also a relatively high incidence. There is a lot of research now being done to try to mitigate post-stroke depression because it decreases a patient's likelihood of feeling motivated for rehab and to gain what their best degree of functional independence. So this is kind of a busy slide, but what's the motivation to recognize symptoms and get people into the hospital to try to get them rapid treatment? Brain cells are called neurons, N-E-U-R-O-N-S. Brain cells are neurons. And when a stroke happens, every second, a lot of neurons are lost, about 32,000. That goes up per minute and per hour. And per completed stroke, there's a lot of neurons or brain cells that are lost. So, and I'm not going to go over those other columns there. The take-home point is that the longer you wait, the more damage occurs, and the more damage that occurs, the more irreversible it becomes. Nerve cells don't heal well. Other cells in the body do. Nerve cells do not. So what can we do? Why are we doing this now? May has been designated National Stroke Awareness Month. We're trying to promote awareness of the signs of stroke. We're trying to use this acronym called FAST. Why do we use this one? Because it'll capture most people who are developing a stroke. It won't capture all, but we're trying to get the most bang for the buck, so to speak. So if you remember, F for face, is there any weakness or asymmetry of the face or drooling or slurring of the speech? Arms, can someone extend their arms or does one arm just stay down? Speech kind of goes along with face, but again, it just reinforces the fact that sometimes facial difficulties and speaking difficulties go together. So is there a weakness of the face? Is speech preserved or not? Is the arm working or not? If you're a little more medically savvy, you might check the leg as well, because sometimes where there's arm weakness, there's leg weakness. But the T is time, and the time is sooner rather than later to call 911 to get someone in to the hospital sooner rather than later. And I'll tell you why that is in a minute. Like I told you earlier, when I was finishing my neurology training in 1993, so 21 years ago, sorry, I lied about that. There wasn't much we could do about strokes. We stood around helplessly trying to decide how much aspirin to give someone or whether or not to give them something called heparin. And we did it, but it didn't work, and it was studied, and the outcomes were never really improved by those interventions. And then some people got together and said, you know, we've been giving this clot-busting drug to people with heart attacks for a few years now, and why not try it in the setting of acute stroke? The mechanisms are similar. In the heart, there's a clot going on in the arteries that supply blood to the heart. It's ironic, you know, because the heart supplies blood to the rest of the body, right? But the heart's a muscle, it's always beating. The heart needs blood and oxygen, much more so than any other muscle in the body. So if an artery in the heart is compromised and the heart can't get the blood and oxygen it needs, it stops functioning, and that's what a heart attack is. Clot-busting drugs can open up those arteries in the heart and allow the heart to get what it needs. So people a lot smarter than me said, hey, we should learn our lesson from what the cardiologists are doing and try this in the setting of stroke, and let's see if it works. We'll get back to that in a minute. So again, we want people to be comfortable in identifying the symptoms of stroke and to look for the sudden or relatively sudden onset of weakness on one side of the body. Looking at their face, asking them to smile, is one side drooping or not? You know, can they show, are their teeth showing on one side, not on the other? Ask the person to raise their arms up if one drifts down or if they just can't get the other arm up, or if the hand on that side is weak and clumsy, then that's a red flag. Ask the person to repeat a simple phrase. Can they speak clearly? Is their speech slurred, or are they speaking nonsensical words? Or are they just struggling to get words out? And if that's the case, you know, the time is now to call for help and to call 911. Why? Why call 911? Why don't I just get them in the car and it'll be quicker? I'll just drop them off in the ER. Why do I have to wait around for the ambulance? Well, you begin a process when you call 911. There's a triage system that we have in place for people who have suspected stroke. And when the EMS people arrive, wherever you are or your loved one is, they will then call the local emergency room and activate and do what we call a stroke activation. So that when that individual arrives in the ER, then they will kind of be brought to the front of the line. They'll be brought into the trauma room right away. They'll get a scan, a CAT scan of their head right away. And they will be considered for a clot-busting drug, a thrombolytic drug, a drug that lyses thrombus, that breaks up clots to try to improve outcome. Okay. So the EMS providers begin by doing some assessments, doing their own stroke assessment, putting in an IV, that'll be helpful. They call ahead to the emergency department, and that activation starts when the EMS people call in. And then there's medical treatment called TPA, tissue plasminogen activator. I don't expect you to remember that name. It is the one and only drug available to treat acute stroke at this stage in time. The one and only drug that is approved to treat acute stroke. That's it. But it's available. And it was studied. The first study came out in 1996. It was found to be favorable. It took a long time for those study results to get into place on a national basis. I moved to Wenatchee in 2000. And where I used to be, we were able to get the stroke activation teams implemented probably by, 1988, 1989. It took a lot longer for it to happen in Wenatchee and in other rural parts of the country. It just took longer for the information to sink in and for people to buy into the fact that, yeah, this is a useful intervention and we should be doing it. TPA is a clot-busting drug. It dissolves clots in the artery that is reducing blood flow to the brain and causing the stroke symptoms. If it's given within the first 4.5 hours of stroke, it can reduce disability and mortality significantly. But I will say that that 4.5 hour window was added on over the past year and a half, mainly because it was found to be relatively safe within that window, but not necessarily more effective than if somebody gets it within 3 hours. So although where I'm supposed to tell you that the window was 4.5 hours, I will tell you that there's nothing to be gained by waiting. Absolutely nothing. Nothing to be gained by waiting. And I have to tell this to the people who work in the emergency room, too, when they say, oh, the window was extended to 4.5 hours, so we can wait on that scan and scan that other person. No, you can't. There's nothing to be gained by waiting. So the issue is if people stay home, like me with my shoulder, and I'm waiting for it to go away after 2 months and it hasn't been going away, if I develop symptoms and I wait, then I don't call, well, then I'm losing an opportunity to have a potentially effective treatment. So, and like I said, it's human nature for people to say, well, this is going to go away. I'm just going to wait it out. But if that's you, if that's your relative, don't let them wait. Get them in. Get the stroke activation going. Because after 4.5 hours, it's too late and we can't offer the treatment. So know the signs of stroke. Tell your friends. Know risk factors for stroke. Try to manage and reduce your risk factors as best you can. Diabetes is a huge risk factor. Know your blood sugar. Control it. Anybody know what? That's right. Just know it. I don't want to get into a lecture on diabetes. Stop smoking. Encourage everybody to stop smoking. It's just a killer. Blood pressure checks. Check it often and at different times of the day. If you've been prescribed a medication, take it. If it's causing side effects, let your doctor know because there's others to try. Don't just stop it. High blood pressure is a major cause of all kinds of strokes, especially the ones that cause bleeding into the brain. Okay. High cholesterol. Know your numbers and stay on target and change your diet. Easier said than done, but worthwhile. Get active. A sedentary lifestyle is a risk for stroke. Even 10 to 20 minutes a day helps. If you have a heart rhythm disorder called atrial fibrillation, the best way to prevent a stroke is to be on a daily blood thinner. Having atrial fibrillation increases your risk of stroke by 500%. Those aren't good odds. Questions so far? Yes, sir.
Say you have a stroke right here and now, and you go to the emergency room and they say, well, you got 4 or 5 hours. Who's there to make sure that I do get that scan?
Well, the ER doctors, the nurse triage team, I mean, it's unlikely that somebody's going to tell you that you need to wait.
Well, just going by your comment earlier that, you know,
yeah,
the people in the ER say, well, we got 4 hours.
Oh, yeah, no. I mean, when the window, I'm sorry, I shouldn't. When the window was extended to 4.5 hours about a year and a half ago, that was the reaction to some people. Well, now we have more time, and what Terry and I have been preaching to the ER is, no, you don't have more time. There's nothing to be gained by waiting for the 4.5 hour window. So go now. Don't put this person on the back burner just because the window has been extended. The window was extended because of the realization that, like, not so much in Wenatchee, but in the towns outlying Wenatchee, there are a lot of rural communities where this type of intervention isn't available locally, and people have to travel long distances. So the NIH did another trial after 1996 to see what happens if the window was extended 4.5 hours. And what they found was there were still benefits, but not as robust as within 3 hours. But they thought the benefit was worth it because the risk of complications was very low. So the message was, let's use this as a way to capture people who are traveling long distances so that we don't deny them the opportunity, but let's not use it as a delay tactic. Okay? Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, if you have AFib and you said you have
500% increased risk of stroke with atrial fibrillation.
How can you reduce that?
By being on a blood thinner on a daily basis.
That's all you have to do?
To reduce the risk? There also are medications to get the heart rate as regular as possible, to get the rate controlled as best as possible. But you still have to watch out for other risks of stroke: high blood pressure, high cholesterol, diabetes. Those risk factors also have to be treated. But if you do nothing else, best to be on a daily blood thinner to reduce the risk of stroke from atrial fibrillation. Did someone? Yes, sir.
Will half an aspirin do?
For atrial fibrillation, will half an aspirin do? No. Okay. All right. Now, there might be some compelling reasons why people can't be on a blood thinner for atrial fibrillation for other medical reasons. But all in all, that's the treatment of choice. Yes, ma'am.
You know, if you're on an aspirin regimen, taking aspirin every morning, now they're saying that's dangerous and you shouldn't be doing it. Have they decided whether it's good or bad to take aspirin?
Yeah, you know, there was something on the news the other night about that. I haven't followed up on it yet, though. And I tend to... Didn't Julie, did you hear? Yeah, I didn't.
I did.
You did? What was the comment?
What they were saying was that there are thousands, probably millions of people that just automatically take a baby aspirin a day and they have no symptoms or anything. You need to be directed by a doctor that knows that you have heart issues or whatever before you ever...
Okay.
Shouldn't take it unless you need to.
Okay, so the comment was that many people, probably because of a lot of the information that's been out from the American Heart Association about heart attack prevention, a lot of people have been just treating themselves with aspirin on a daily basis, and the comment here was that maybe it should be relegated, the use should be on a daily basis, should be relegated to people who have risk factors, identifiable risk factors for heart attack and stroke. And that people who are otherwise in good health should not necessarily be taking them on a daily basis because of other potential complications, bleeding being the most worrisome of those. Yes, sir?
What about nitroglycerin
pill? I don't know about much about nitroglycerin. I don't prescribe it. It's used to treat angina. And if you have angina, it's worth using, but I don't prescribe it, and so I can't comment more than that about it. It's just not something that neurologists prescribe very much. So sorry that I can't answer that very intelligently. So what does the stroke program do? We at Confluence Health have partnered with the University of Washington and Harborview Medical Center to provide telephonic stroke services. We started this June 1st of last year. They have 8 board-certified stroke specialists who answer their telephone quickly. And so if someone comes into our emergency department with symptoms of stroke, we are able to get a hold of them in a timely manner, share the patient's story, their scan information, their other medical risk factors, and get a decision quickly as to whether or not they might be a good candidate to receive the clot-busting drug called TPA. We are what's called a level 2 stroke care center. I can let Terry talk exactly about what a level 2 means, but we're the only one in the region. These partnerships and our state designation allow us to give TPA to our patients and allow us to keep patients in our facility. Without those designations, people would have to go to another facility. We didn't think that would be fair to the people of the community. That's why we've embarked on having this become a more robust and locally and statewide and hopefully nationally recognized stroke care hospital. If patients need a higher level of care for surgery, if they had a devastating bleed into their brain and they require surgical services that we don't have available here, then we have a transport system set up where they can travel to Harborview and get the assistance they need. So thank you, and I will answer more questions. You would be eligible to receive TPA. You would be eligible. And that can happen sometimes, sir, because sometimes a heart attack can weaken the heart muscle enough where it causes the heart to beat irregularly. And like I mentioned earlier, blood doesn't like to be pooled. Blood likes to be moving all the time. And when blood doesn't move, when the blood doesn't flow, it likes to clot. So if one part of the heart muscle is damaged or in the process of being damaged and the heart is beating in an irregular way, pooling of blood or clot can form and that could travel to the brain. So again, in that setting, you would be eligible. An individual would be eligible to receive TPA. Yes, sir?
Does the paramedic or ACAR people carry anything special?
The question is, the paramedics carry anything special? At this point in time, they do not. Not for stroke, but they will start an IV and they will alert the emergency room and they will get you there fast and you will go from the ambulance directly to the CT scanner.
It's much quicker. They'll also check for stroke mimics, like they'll check your blood sugar to see if your blood sugar is low, things like that.
Yeah, there are some things that mimic a stroke, but again, you don't want to take that chance, but sometimes if someone is a diabetic and their blood sugar is too high or too low, they can develop symptoms that look like a stroke. But we always want to assume it's a stroke until proven otherwise. Because it's impossible to know. Unless you get evaluated, it's just impossible to know.
EMS personnel are actually pretty good at predicting whether someone's having a stroke. So if you think you're having a stroke and they come do a quick assessment and get you loaded up in the ambulance, it's been proven that 89% of their assessments, of their mini stroke assessment, the patient has gone on to have a stroke. So they're pretty good at recognizing the symptoms.
And this has been a partnership with hospitals and EMS, and the next step is partnering with the community. And that's you and your friends and your family. So that's why we thank you for coming. We wish there were more of you here. We do ask you, if you feel like it, to take some extra information and to pass it out to anyone who you think might benefit from it. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question. My husband just recently had a slight stroke, and the main issue is memory. What are the chances of that coming back completely?
Hard to know without knowing exactly what part of the brain was affected. Hard to know. I will say in general that strokes generally do not, stroke symptoms usually do not resolve or come back 100%. Generally not. Yes, ma'am.
A heart murmur is a valve issue, I guess.
Yeah, a heart murmur is generally caused by turbulent blood flow over a valve.
Does that increase the risk?
Not in and of itself, no. No, not in and of itself. I will tell you the one exception. That sometimes people develop heart murmurs if a heart valve gets infected. But an infected heart valve behaves in a very abrupt and disruptive way and can cause strokes. But the usual scenario is that a murmur caused from a disruption of a heart valve is generally not associated with stroke. Yep. All right, well, thank you all for coming. We appreciate it.